Thanks to Skillshare for supporting this episode of Journey to the Microcosmos. The first 1,000 people to click on the link in the description can get a 1-month free trial of Skillshare's premium membership. Oceans and lakes are filled with copepods, a myriad of small crustacean species that might float as plankton or infect other creatures. And as they're living in whatever manner best suits them, some copepods, like our friend here, become more than just their own creature. They become a surface, a place for someone else or something else to settle down upon. In the case of this copepod, the residents that have taken root on its carapace are many, many ciliates. They're single-celled bodies accumulating into a microscopic bouquet. And before we get into the specifics of what's going on with this meeting of crustacean and ciliate, I want to ask you a quick question. Don't overthink it. Just go with your gut instinct. Who would you rather be in this scenario, the copepod or the ciliate? Now, I promise you, there's no right answer to this question. It's just something that's interesting to think about whenever we peer into the microcosmos and see creatures with habits that seem quite different to our own. Though we should note that we do have some things in common with the microcosmos in this context. Our skin is covered with its own array of microbes, an invisible community of bacteria and fungi and other creatures that affect the way our bodies interact with the world around us. So if you were asked who you would rather be, a human or a microbe living on a human, we would not blame you at all if you stuck with what's familiar and instinctively went with a human being, please. But the microbiome on our skin has a different experience than, say, these ciliates growing on a rotifer. For one, they spend their lives in water, which means they have a completely different environment shaping their needs and microbial relationships. Plus, they are a whole lot smaller than us. So that's where we are going to focus today. What happens when one tiny creature decides to live on another tiny creature? There's a name for this kind of relationship, epibiosis, and it's not limited to the microcosmos or to water environments. It might help to think of it as the flip side of another relationship we've watched play out in the microcosmos, endosymbiosis, where one creature decides to live on the inside of another one, like these algae growing inside of a hydra. But the relationship between endosymbionts and their host can look different depending on the species. But in cases like these, it might be the host providing shelter in the form of their bodies in exchange for nutrients made by their endosymbiont. In contrast, epibiosis is when one creature decides to live on the outside of another one. And sometimes epibiosis is super obvious, like it was with the copepod that we started out with. But take a look at this dynamoeba. This organism was first described by the American naturalist Joseph Leidy in the 19th century. And from a distance, it doesn't seem like the dynamoeba has much going on. There's certainly no ornate flowery growths protruding from it. But when you zoom in, you can see all sorts of bacteria and archaea arranged on its surface. In this case, those bacteria and archaea are epibionts, which is the name that we give to organisms growing on top of another organism. And the dynamoeba is the basabiont, the organism that the epibionts are growing upon. And in the microcosmos, sometimes you are the basabiont and other times you are the epibiont. This leafy ciliate zoothamnium, for example, can be found growing on copepods, similar to how we found our ciliates in the beginning of this video. But we have also found zoothamnium with euglenoids growing on them like their green sprinkles that stay glued to their stalks. And we've even seen strange sights like these prokaryotes growing on top of a larger prokaryote, though we are not sure what species they are or what they might be getting out of this nearness to one another. And given the diversity in epibionts, the way that they attach themselves to the basabiont varies a lot as well. For the smallest microbes, their path towards their new surface is shaped by the viscous forces around them that creates a wall of water they have to break through before they can latch onto their new home. And for unicellular eukaryotes, or even multicellular ones, the decision to attach itself to another creature might just be another part of a longer life cycle, a shift from a free-swimming self that ages into something willing to settle down using an adhesive molecule to glue them together. And if you are the basabiont, welcoming these epibionts might actually work out well for you. These new residents might provide you with some nutrition that you are lacking, supplying metabolic byproducts that are now in very close proximity. These epibionts might even help you hide from predators, masking the chemical cues that give your location away. But there are trade-offs as well. For one, you are literally shouldering the weight of other organisms. In water, that can make all the difference, affecting your speed and buoyancy, and epibionts can even get in the way of important needs, blocking off sun or impeding reproductive organs from their usual functions. Meanwhile, for the epibiont, there are pros and cons as well. Life on another creature means that you've got free transportation wherever your basabiont chooses to go, and these surfaces often make for great places to grab the remains of whatever your basabiont is eating. But life is also unstable on a living surface. When your basabiont grows or sheds or experiences some other major life change, you, the epibiont, will find the very ground beneath you changing as well. There's this disadvantage inherent to both the epibiont and basabiont life. In one paper, we found the term they used was shared doom, which is a more poetic way to say this. If they get eaten, you get eaten too. And it is a strange consequence to think about, that this partnership makes its individuals vulnerable to new threats. The basabiont now faces the epibiont's predators, and vice versa, as their identities have commingled and blurred together. And yet, they are still two distinct entities, one lived upon, the other living upon. So ask the question again, which would you rather be, the epibiont or the basabiont? Or maybe there is little difference between the two, each shaped by the whims of the other. Because ultimately, in some way, every organism on Earth, it has to be said, is both lived upon and lives upon, just as we are shaped by the microbes on our skin and the Earth under our feet. But next week, we're going to focus on one case of epibiosis, where we think the answer is perhaps a bit cleaner. Thank you for coming on this journey with us as we explore the unseen world that surrounds us. And we'd also like to say thank you to Skillshare for supporting this video. You can learn a lot on Skillshare, from gardening to cooking or illustration. You can learn how to script, shoot, and edit your own YouTube videos from one of the most successful creators on the platform, Marques Brownlee. Drawing on a decade of experience, Marques opens up his process like never before, guiding you step by step through every stage of content creation, from scripting and storyboarding to shooting and editing. You'll learn how to create videos that connect, whether you have one follower or 100,000. Skillshare is an online learning community with thousands of inspiring classes for anyone who loves learning and wants to explore their creativity and learning skills. With so much to explore and real-world projects to create, Skillshare empowers you to accomplish real growth. It's curated specifically for learning, meaning there are no ads to distract you, and they're always launching new premium classes so you can stay focused on leveling up your skills. If you're one of the first 1,000 people to click on the link in the description, you can get a 1-month free trial of Skillshare's premium membership. And speaking of organisms relying on other organisms, these are our Patreon patrons. They are the people who make it possible to make the thing that we make. Thank you so much to all of them for being a part of what we do. It is a pretty small percentage of the folks who watch who make it possible for everyone to enjoy what we do here at Journey to the Microcosmos. So if you want to join me in feeling grateful to them right now, I very much appreciate it. And if you would like to join them, you can find us at patreon.com/journeytomicro. If you want to see more from our master of microscopes, James Weiss, you can check out Jam and Germs on Instagram. And if you want to see more from us, there's always a subscribe button somewhere nearby.